Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. What a venue, what an exciting program, what a wonderful host you are here in Tokyo. I'm Lars Therkildsen, CEO at HOFOR, Greater Copenhagen Utility. Thank you for inviting me to present we as a multi-utility contribute to make our city sustainable and livable also. Let me first introduce you to HOFOR. We are the largest utility company in Denmark with 1,300 employees serving 1 million customers. We are fully owned by Copenhagen municipality and surrounding municipality around Copenhagen also. In HOFOR, we are supplying drinking water, wastewater, stormwater services, district heating, district cooling, town gas, and renewable energy to our customers. We are operating under strictly governmental regulation on efficiency, and by preventing smart solutions, we maintain our services green, safe, and cheap. We signed the principles for WaterWise in Brisbane year 2016 and include the SDGs in our business strategies as well. Let me start by looking back at major achievements in the past, then continue with the present day's activities. Modern utility in Denmark takes its starting point at the cholera epidemic during the summer of 1853. Which claimed about 5% of the city's population in Denmark, in Copenhagen. Doctors and engineers wanted that the city was vulnerable, warned that the city was vulnerable to the cholera, which was infesting cities all over Europe through the mid-1800s. Introducing centralized water supply, replacing the old wooden pipes with cast iron pipes, and sewering the city made the city resilient to further attacks from any infectious in intestinal diseases. The brick sewer on the right side here is from 1866, is today one of our cloudburst outlets to the harbor of Copenhagen. The intervention was successful and cholera never returned to Copenhagen. That's really old pictures I can see now. Bath in Copenhagen, our harbor, was popular for hundreds of years. Here you can see the emerging conflicts between swimmers and ships. And in the 1950s, the water quality in the harbor was so poor that swimming and fishing was permanently prohibited. During the 1970s and the 80s, beaches all over the country experienced closure, and fishermen caught dead fishes and dead lobsters as well. A national plan to protect all receiving water were implemented by all Danish municipalities between 1970 and year 2000. Copenhagen prepared a sewage master plan leading to construction of retention basins, closing of overflows to recipients, and construction of 3 wastewater treatment plants. Here is shown a construction of retention basin in 1997 with a volume of 30,000 cubic meters. The result in Copenhagen was opening of city bathing areas in 2002 and permission to catch pelagic fish in 2005. No diseases outbreaks have been recorded related to bathing or fishing in Copenhagen harbor till today. Water consumption in Copenhagen grew quickly from 1860 and onwards. And in 1970, it came close to 200 liters per day. The household consumption was generally 60 or 65% of the total consumption. Through the 1970s, water meters were installed at all buildings, which together with increase in water tariffs and better leakage control reduced water consumption dramatically. Water savings campaign further reduced to consumption, and the daily per capita consumption is now on and moving below the target of 100 liter per day. Copenhagen municipality has prepared a climate plan in connection with COP15 that took place in Copenhagen in 2009, and this climate plan is still the framework of many of our activities. The climate plan is setting targets for mitigation as well as setting up the frame for an adaptation plan. An important target in the plan, in the climate plan, is for Copenhagen to be the first capital in the world to be carbon neutral. And how is HOFOR contributing to achieving this goal? Within district heating, I can first inform you that in Denmark, all household waste is incinerated and converted into heat and power. We are also converting from natural gas or coal to biomass in existing power station, and we are now replacing the old district heating system in Copenhagen, which was based on steam and is now based on hot water. And with better insulated pipes, we have a much lower loss from the pipes. Overall result is estimated to be that 80% of the district heating supply would be carbon neutral in the year 2020. Within district cooling, a 70% reduction in carbon emission is achieved compared to individual system, among others, by using harbor water for cooling. Presently, about 100 megawatt district cooling is connected now. For town gas, biogas from wastewater treatment plants are contributing to carbon reduction as well. Presently, 30% of town gas is carbon neutral today. Our work with renewable energy includes setting up windmills, and we are well on the way to our target to have 360 megawatt installed by year 2025. Finally, we are planting forests around our groundwater boreholes, and of course we are using electric vehicles for transportation in our company. Within water supplies, we believe that we are the capital city with the lowest energy consumption per cubic meter. That comes out of the tap. We are on 0.3 kilowatt hour per cubic meter. Part of the reason for having this low energy consumption is our low water loss. Our water resource is 100% groundwater based, and there's no need to groundwater based, and therefore there's no need for using chlorination for disinfecting the water. We are also promoting that people should drink water from the tap. 1 liter of tap water emits 900 times less carbon compared to 1 liter of water in a plastic bottle. Tap water in general has the lowest content of unwanted chemicals compared to most of the bottled water. Therefore, consumers are beginning to shift to reusable containers, and restaurants are serving tap water in jars instead of plastic bottles. We have installed solar panels in all our waterworks and a major sewer pumping stations as well. Here's an example from waterworks where you can see our consumption from the power grid in year 2014 before installing the solar panels. After the panels were installed, you can see what we are drawing down to zero from the grid on a good sunny day. And we do have sunny days in Denmark, as you know. And it's all solar power based. On an annual basis, this has resulted in a 25% reduction in the power bought from the grid. Copenhagen City prepared a climate adaptation plan following extreme rain events in the city, and this adaptation plan is addressing the issue of more and heavier rainfall, rising sea level, and the fact that the weather is getting warmer in our city. In July 2011, we experienced a serious cloudburst that made Copenhagen look like Venice. This was a real game changer, impacting citizens and politicians and making people aware that this was something we needed to do something about. The losses were high when the rain was running into basement, flooding them and damaged properties. With over 90,000 insurance claims, the public awareness of climate change increased, and the government responded with new legislation stating that making the city resilient against cloudburst should be financed through the water bill. In close cooperation with HOFOR, the municipality prepared a cloudburst management plan, identifying over 300 projects on public land and further hundreds of projects on private land, private streets and housing estates. Every project, from a small green street to metro-sized tunnel, has now a role in realizing the comprehensive plan. The plan provides investment levels that are feasible related to the potential loss the coming 100 years, and states the magnitude of rain the city should be protected against. The cloudburst management plan is defining how utility is responsible for pipes and tunnels on public land, which is traditional business for us. The city takes care of urban space and improvements, which means interventions above ground. The private land owners have to protect their own structures against water up to a certain level and finance it themselves. HOFOR is also implementing green streets and providing roof water for urban waterscapes. This is a new challenge for a utility, but both intervention contributes to handling rain where it falls and minimize the centralized cloudburst transportation system. It further contributes the cool to the city during the hot summers and makes it the year round more attractive and livable to the citizens. We find a great benefit from letting our young water professional participate and contribute to the activities in Iowa. Young water professionals are professionals are meeting across countries and professions. We support and participate in the annual two-week Copenhagen Urban Lab and a three-week course in urbanization and health at the Copenhagen University, where the results were impressive, innovating and inspiring for us. Emerging water leaders must understand how to contribute resiliency and livability, which means being able to communicate and cooperate with other professionals than your own. From different entities, university, utility, manufacturers, contractors, and be inspired across country as well. A mutual utility can contribute to mitigation and adaptation and describe above, but the new challenges will be around the corner all the time, and doing our daily work will be to be combined with a high degree of alert, flexibility, and innovation. Protection of public health was and will always be a main objective of a utility. Without provision of basic services and in a reliable and affordable way, the citizens' health will be challenged. Taking a bike ride to the harbor for relaxing or jumping into the clean harbor water has become a symbol of livability in Copenhagen. And I hope I see you all in year 2020. Thank you for your attention.